Hello students, welcome on Microbiology by Santosh Napte YouTube channel. Friends, in last lecture of this applied microbiology paper, we have studied about the types of water and sources of microorganisms in water. Today we will see about index of water pollution. And then we will see about the different types of indicator microorganisms including coliform bacteria. So these are the next point in this second unit of applied microbiology, and the name of this second unit is water microbiology. In this topic we are studying all aspects or microbiological aspects of water. So that's why this branch of microbiology, it is called as water microbiology. So here first we will see what is meant by water pollution. So water pollution is the contamination of water bodies such as lakes, rivers, oceans, aquifers and groundwater due to the different types of human activities. So all of these water bodies, they get contaminated with different components which are added by human activities, and this contamination of water bodies, it is called as water pollution. So that's why we can see here this water pollution, it results when the contaminants are introduced into the water bodies or these natural environments. At the same time, releasing of inadequately treated wastewater or untreated wastewater into these natural water bodies, that can leads to degradation of aquatic ecosystems present in that particular water, and that can lead to a public health problems for those peoples which are living surrounding to that natural environments. So these peoples living surrounding to these natural environments, they use the same polluted river water for drinking, for bathing or for irrigation purposes. So there is a use of this polluted water, and that's why this use of this polluted water, it causes the death and disease in the human beings, because whatever that diseases occurs in that people which are living surrounding to this polluted environment, they suffer from different types of waterborne diseases, and they cause, or there is an occurrence of death of such pupils in that environment. So here continues what is meant by that water pollution. So there are different causes of water pollution, and that includes chemicals that may be organic or that may be inorganic. Then later on, different types of pathogens. Pathogens means here that particular or microbial agents which can cause diseases. So these are called as pathogens. So that pathogens, they also contribute to the pollution of water. And then that physical parameters, which includes elevated temperature as well as discoloration. So these disease causing microorganisms, which we can call as a pathogens, and they can produce or develop waterborne diseases in human being as well as in animals. For example, here that coliform bacteria, which are not actually the cause of disease, but are commonly used as a bacterial indicator of water pollution. Means we can identify whether that water is polluted or not just by detecting the presence of this coliform bacteria in that particular water sample. So that's why that coliform organisms, these are also called as an index of water pollution, because presence of that coliforms in water, it indicates that water is polluted. So that's why it is called as index of water pollution. So we will see here what is meant by index of water pollution. So the presence of living organisms in any water body, it is the main index of water pollution. Whatever that microorganisms or organisms, they are present in water, and presence of any living body or organism in water, it indicates water pollution, or we can say that act as an index of water pollution. And in polluted water bodies, we can observe there is a diminishing of almost all living organisms. This is mainly because of the presence of toxic heavy metals, then organic as well as inorganic compounds, and lack of dissolved oxygen. So all these results, that may be accumulation or presence of toxic heavy metals, presence of organic and inorganic compounds, or lack of or absence of dissolved oxygen, it results due to the pollution of that particular water. Normally, if a water is of good quality, then the amount of dissolved oxygen in that water, it varies from 4 to 7 milligram per liter. This is the normal quantity or amount of oxygen in good quality water. But if that water is polluted, then the dissolved oxygen will be less than 1 milligram per liter. So that's why the highly polluted water, it has very less amount of dissolved oxygen, and that's why the organisms living in that particular aquatic ecosystem, there is an occurrence of death. See, this highly polluted water, it also develops black color as well as foul smell. And the normal pH of good quality water, it is between 6 to 7, whereas the pH of polluted water is highly acidic or it is highly alkaline. So, occurrence of such different parameters, it clearly indicates that water is polluted or it is highly polluted. Now, what are indicators of water pollution? Because these indicators of water pollution, they play very important role in deciding whether that water is or that can be used for potable purposes or it is unpotable. So that's why these indicators of water pollution, these are very important. But before going further, we will see what are these indicators of water pollution. So there are different types of indicator bacteria which are used to detect and estimate the level of fecal contamination of water. Because if that particular persons are suffering from diseases, the fecal matter of that persons, they consist of pathogenic microorganisms. And if such fecal matter get discharged or get contaminated with that potable water or drinking water, so that pathogens can be present in that water. And that's why these presence of these indicator bacteria in that water or that indicates fecal contamination of particular water. And they are not dangerous to the human health, but that can be used to indicate the presence of a health risk which are present in that fecal matter. Normally, each gram of human fecal matter, it consists of approximately 1 billion bacteria, that is 1 into 10 raised to the power 11 bacteria. This number of bacteria, it is present in 1 gram of that fecal matter of the human being. And these bacteria are of different types, that may include pathogenic bacteria, for example Salmonella or Campylobacter, or which are, this is associated with gastroenteritis. And in addition to this, that fecal matter also consists of pathogenic viruses, then it consists of pathogenic protozoa as well as other parasites. This fecal material can enter the environment from different types of sources, including the wastewater treatment plants, and this fecal matter later on, it can causes the contamination of the water which is used for drinking purposes. So again, we will continue here. What are these indicators of water pollution? So if sufficient quantities are ingested, then these fecal pathogens, they can cause diseases in the human being. Because if that contaminated water is drink by people or persons, and if large quantity or sufficient quantities are present in that water, then these fecal pathogens, they can develop diseases in that human being. And that the variety as well as low concentration of pathogens in environmental waters, it makes difficult to test for the individually. So therefore, public agencies use the presence of other more abundant or more easily detectable fecal bacteria, and that can be used as indicators for the presence of fecal contamination. So presence of that indicator bacteria or fecal indicator bacteria indicates the presence of fecal contamination, and that indicates the presence of pathogenic microorganisms in the water. So here, There are different types of microorganisms or microbes that can be used as indicators of water pollution. So these commonly used indicator bacteria that includes total coliforms, then there is a subset of this that includes fecal coliforms, and generally these are found in the intestinal tracts of warm-blooded animals. So these total coliforms were used as fecal indicators by public agencies in the United States or in India also, and that was from as early as the 1920. These organisms, they can identify it based on the fact that they all metabolize the sugar, that is lactose, and they produce acid and gas as the byproducts. So these fecal coliforms, these are more useful as indicators in recreational waters as compared to total coliforms, and that includes the species which are naturally found in plants and soil. However, there are some species of fecal coliforms that actually do not have the fecal origin, and that is the example is Klebsiella pneumoniae. They does not have the fecal origin. So now there is a use of that organisms which are actually not pathogenic, but presence of these organisms in water, it indicates fecal contamination or there is a presence of pathogenic organisms. But why there is no direct detection of pathogens instead of indicator organisms? Why we are not detecting that pathogens directly to decide whether that water is polluted or not? The reasons are here. The first reason is these pathogens, they do not survive for a longer period of time. So these can be missed in a sample which is submitted to the laboratory for analysis. So these organisms, these pathogens can be missed. Second reason is here, they are present in very small numbers, and that's why they can escape during the detection by a laboratory test. For example, here water sample in which that 1000 Salmonella typhi are present in 1 liter of that water sample, and if we take 0.1 ml of this water sample which is used to inoculate the medium, then it does not contain even a single cell of the pathogen. So in such cases, this pathogen, that is Salmonella typhi, it can be escaped during the laboratory testing, and that laboratory report will be that water is potable for drinking purposes, but actually that pathogens are present here, but these are very less in number. Next reason is generation time of these pathogens, it is greater than non-pathogens, and that can be outnumbered by other fast growing non-pathogenic organisms, and therefore with examination of pathogens. So these are the characteristics of a good indicator organisms. Because when that particular organism or bacteria is used as a indicator organisms, then that bacteria or microorganism must fulfill particular characteristics or particular criteria. And this criteria includes that United States Environmental Protection Agency or EPA, it lists the different types of criteria for that particular organism to be act as an ideal indicator of fecal contamination. The first criteria is that organism should be present whenever enteric pathogens are present. If that pathogens are absent and if that indicator organism is present, then on the basis of this, both should be present at the same time here. Second criteria is the organism should be useful for all types of water, whether it is recreational water, whether it is drinking purposes water, whatever that. Next one, the organism should have a longer survival time than the hardiest enteric pathogen. So that indicator organism should have a longer survival time. Next one or next criteria is the organism should not grow in water. So it should not grow in water. Next criteria, the organism should be found in warm-blooded animals' intestine. It should be present in that warm-blooded animal's intestine. And next one is actually none of that any organism or indicator organism is there which currently in use and which can fit all of these criteria perfectly. So there are some drawbacks are there, or some particular bacteria they are missing that particular criteria, but there are few organisms are there which can fulfill maximum criteria which are essential to act as a good indicator. Now the next slide is why to use indicator microorganisms. what is the necessity of using of this indicator microorganisms. So there are different types of pathogenic, that is disease causing organisms, and that can be found in contaminated drinking water. So that includes bacteria, viruses, parasites, that is cryptosporidium, and these are the cause of largest documented waterborne disease outbreak, which was took place in United States. So there are many known pathogens which are both difficult as well as expensive to detect through water sampling and testing. So it is simply not practical to monitor for every microorganisms which are present in drinking water or that is coming from the source. So for this reason, and this United States public health personnel, they relied on indicator organism approach. So presence of these indicator organisms, it indicates the microbiological quality of drinking water, whether it is unpotable for drinking purposes or whether it is potable for drinking purposes, that can be indicated by using this indicator microorganisms. And as we have seen in previous slides, that detection of pathogens directly, it is very tedious job or risky job. So that's why there is a use of indicator microorganisms. So we will see here which are different types of indicator microorganisms. The commonly used indicator microorganism, these are called as coliform bacteria, particularly it is Escherichia coli. So this coliform group, it is a group of bacteria that occur naturally in large numbers in the intestine and fecal matter of all warm-blooded animals, including humans, then different types of mammals as well as birds. And these coliform bacteria that can also be found in soil as well as throughout the environment. But mostly they are present in intestine, that's why, or in colon, so that's why it is a coliform. So these coliforms and Escherichia coli, these are easy as well as inexpensive to detect. Their presence in water sample, that can be used as a, or it is used as an indicator of quality of water, and more specifically possible fecal contamination by humans or animals. So these coliforms and these E. coli, so that can be used as an indicator of microorganisms, and so that can be used for detection or determining of the quality of water. So but that coliforms as well as E. coli, these are useful indicators, they have some limitations. For example, because there are some enteric protozoa as well as viruses which are resistant to that disinfection processes as compared to bacteria, and therefore the absence of E. coli, it does not necessarily indicate the absence of these waterborne protozoa or that waterborne viral diseases. So this is the one limitation for the use of coliforms as well as E. coli as an indicator microorganisms. So these coliforms as an index of water pollution, that is mostly used, and as I already told here, these coliforms, these are the group of intestinal bacteria which are characterized by fermentation of lactose sugar at 37 degrees Celsius within 24 to 48 hours with the production of acid and gas, that is carbon dioxide and water. So these coliforms which are lactose fermenting, that is they can ferment lactose sugar and produces acid and gas. So these coliforms, they produces pink colonies when grown on McConkie's agar medium, whereas the lactose non-fermenters, that is they cannot ferment that lactose sugar, they produces colorless colonies. And these coliforms, they are gram-negative short rods. See, this is the diagram here which shows coliform bacteria, that is lactose fermenting colonies here, which are pink in color, and on the right side here there is colorless colonies which are of non-lactose fermenting bacteria. So in this way we can differentiate lactose fermenters and lactose non-fermenters. Lactose fermenters, they produces or they ferment lactose sugar and produces acid and gas and forms pink color colonies. Then lactose non-fermenters, they cannot use lactose sugar present in that nutrient medium, and therefore there is no production of acid and gas, and that's why the colonies of these lactobacillus fermenters, these are colorless. Then there are different types of organisms are there. So we can say that is a waterborne diseases which are caused by pathogens, and they enter into these water bodies through the intestinal discharge of the humans, that is through the fecal matter or other animals which are suffering from the that particular diseases. So these E. coli and other coliforms, including this fecal streptococcus, that should be in italics, these E. coli or that fecal streptococcus, that is Streptococcus fecalis and Clostridium perfringens. Just keep in mind these when you are typing the names of these bacteria, for example here, that should be in italics, and when you are writing, that should be underlined separately. So just keep in mind that. So this Streptococcus fecalis and Clostridium perfringens, these are the normal inhabitants of the large intestine of humans and other animals, and that can be released into fecal matter or in feces. And when such fecal matter or feces get mixed with the municipal water supply, so presence of these fecal coliforms or these indicator organisms in that water supply indicates there is a possibility of presence of pathogenic microorganisms. So there are three different types of indicator microorganisms are there. One is Escherichia coli, then second one is fecal streptococci, and third one is the Clostridium, more specifically it is Clostridium perfringens. So this one by one we will see here. The first one is Escherichia coli, or in short it is called as E. coli. It is a strictly intestinal, and presence of this bacteria in water, it indicates fecal contamination or it indicates fecal pollution, and that can be easily isolated from these water samples using a selective media, for example McConkie's agar, because you can differentiate or you can easily identify it that whether that water sample consists of E. coli or not. If there is a occurrence of pink color colonies on that McConkie's agar, so this presence of pink color colonies, that indicates the presence of that coliforms or E. coli in that water sample. Later on you can confirm by carrying out or by performing the IMVIC test, that is indol, methyl red, Hoogas Proskauer and citrate test. So this can be differentiated from Enterobacter aerogens just by using the IMVIC test and Ezekman test. And detection of E. coli in treated drinking water, it directly indicates contamination from the human or animal waste, because they are coming from the intestine, and indirectly there is a presence of different types of pathogenic microorganisms, that may be enteric viruses, that may be bacteria, or that may be parasites. But there are some strains of E. coli are there, again keep in mind here this should be in italics, there are some E. coli cells are there which are pathogenic, and they can cause diarrhea, then they can cause urinary tract infections as well as intestinal hemorrhage, and they can cause failure of kidneys, and which finally results into the death of that particular human being. But almost all enteric pathogens which are released in large numbers in the excreta or fecal matter of infected humans and animals, and many pathogens and diseases they can cause in the all these living things, or they can share between the species. Then second type of indicator microorganism is fecal streptococci. So this fecal streptococci that can be detected in water samples using a special or selective media, and the name of that selective media is, in case of this fecal streptococci, it is sodium azide glucose broth. So this sodium azide, which is present in this sodium azide glucose broth, it inhibits the gram negative bacteria, and presence of this bacteria in water can be confirmed by streaking a loop full of this positive sodium azide glucose broth tube on ethyl violet azide glucose agar. And this ethyl violet and sodium azide, they inhibit virtually all the bacteria except fecal, or except fecal origin. See, this is the test, that is positive test for fecal streptococcus, and it is the part of presumptive test. So it is initially, before inoculation, this nutrient medium is sterile nutrient medium, and which is a glucose broth containing sodium azide. Now this sodium azide, it is highly toxic, but it act to select for this streptococcus group, because it select the growth of streptococci, but it inhibit the or it is toxic for other bacteria or microorganisms. And when this broth tube, it is inoculated with water sample, then it is incubated for 48 hours at 35 to 37 degrees Celsius. And after incubation, if that medium or that broth becomes turbid, so this turbidity indicates the positive test. Therefore, an organism which is present that is likely to be a part of this streptococci group, because that streptococci, they can grow in this nutrient medium, and it means there is a fecal contamination of that water sample, that is indirectly means there is a presence of pathogenic microorganisms. Then third type of indicator microorganism is Clostridium, or it is Clostridium perfringens. So this species of Clostridium, that is Clostridium perfringens, it is anaerobic and it requires specific techniques for the detection as well as isolation. Then bifidobacteria, that is Lactobacillus bifidus, it can enter in water from other sources as than fecal matter. Then Enterobacter aerogens, although it is present in human as well as animal intestine, it is also present or found on grains and plants, and presence of these bacteria in drinking water bodies actually does not confirm the fecal pollution, because it can also enter into water from the that grains as well as plants. So here we finish that three different types of coliform bacteria, and in this way, in this lecture, we have completed that is indicators of water pollution, and then we have studied about the different types of indicator microorganisms including coliform bacteria. So students, to know about my upcoming videos, kindly subscribe this channel, that is Microbiology by Santosh Napte, because in coming days, in future, I am definitely adding the different videos on our syllabus. So kindly subscribe this channel and get notified with different videos which will be uploaded in future. Thank you.